Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back once again to Boyertown Area Senior High School, where tonight your Boyertown Bears will play host to the Wildcats of Owen J. Roberts. As always, I'm Jim Towers, being joined tonight in the color commentating duties by the best the pack has to offer, the Reverend John T. Kaleda.
Hey, Jim.
John, let's dispense with the formalities of some of our pregame discussions here, because after a few games we've done with the boys, quite frankly, really comes down to two things. Are they going to make their three-pointers, and are they going to rebound the ball?
You know, I went back and I watched some of their Upper Perk game, which we know they jumped out to that huge lead early. Went back and watched some of the O&J game from last time, their first game, a 74-70 loss for the Bears. And I was looking for, you know, some sort of clue as to what happened last game. Like maybe they hadn't taken a lot of quick shots in their earlier games, and maybe that Methacton game was just kind of like an abnormal thing for them. And I got to tell you, Jim, this is kind of just who they've been so far this year. They like to shoot the ball quick. The offensive rebounding for other teams has been an Achilles heel for them. So it was really nothing different during the Methacton game. It's just that two times this year, the Bears have shot extremely well and won a couple of ball games, and then a few times this year, the shots just have not been falling for them. I laud their lineups a lot this year by saying, look at all those shooters on the floor, and they do have a lot of shooters, but what that's been doing, Jim, I think, is you got a lot of shooters who want that outside shot, and that's created that stagnant offense that we've been seeing the past couple of games. We have a lot of shooters hanging out just wanting to get that shot, but really, outside of Eric Salada, there's not a player who can consistently break his opponent down to kick out for those shots. So I'm willing to wager that a big focal point in practice yesterday was movement on offense, finding a way to create shots for yourself and create shots for your teammates, and hopefully they do that tonight, and hopefully they fall for the Bears.
You laud this lineup, John. That's a great English teacher word.
Thanks. I'm not trying to circumvent my responsibilities.
That's just phenomenal. The other pregame thing we need to talk about, John, is I was very, very impressed with my pregame snack today. I was really torn with what to do for pregame snack, and I went with an old standby that I haven't had in a while, but man, that comes through every time. The Wawa Italian pinwheel.
Explain.
It's basically like Italian meats in like a wrap, and then they cut them into four pieces, so it's like a snack. And they're little pinwheels about this big each. And I realize I'm saying about this big while we're no cameras on us, but they're about the size of a silver dollar.
Okay, so...
And they're just...
So
they're,
sandwiches they're, the size of a silver dollar. So you got, what, like three of those?
No, it was a snack, because I'm still going to have dinner after this, but it was great. But my disappointment was because Wawa has empanadas now. They are very good.
I did see that.
They are very good. They didn't have any chicken empanadas today, so I had to go Italian pinwheel, and I was very happy with my decision.
I'm happy for you, Jim. I'm going to snack on my Sour Patch Kids over here, and they'll be gone in about 30 seconds.
Good to know, John. We got about a minute and 49 seconds till tip-off. Like you said earlier, the last matchup we had, very high-scoring affair. Boyertown lost in a close one, 74-70. So we will see if we get something similar to that. They are also expanding our duties up here tonight, John. We are going to be taking a break here because we will have national anthem duties as well as announcing starting lineups from the booth. So we will have our microphones off, but the fans watching on the NFHS network should still be able to hear those starting lineups through the PA system.
We kind of do it all up here. Announce different things, eat pinwheels. We do it all.
We are Renaissance men. You can be Da Vinci. I'll be Michelangelo. Like the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Oh, I want Raphael.
Okay. All right, we'll be back after starting lineups and national anthem.
Featuring
We are back. Fantastic job, John, on the starting lineups. Nice to see the teams getting a little bit back here. Great experience for them, especially the seniors, hearing their names announced again before the game. So it's great they have that. Great we have the senior parents back in the gym. But, you know, everything, all of that pales in comparison. I always want to mention, I'm always going to have a soft spot in my heart for the spring athletes of last season who pretty much lost everything. So it's great that these kids are getting something, but they certainly got more than a lot of kids did, that's for sure.
Agreed.
As right off the tip, to fight for it right at midcourt, Eric Salata doing a lot of great pressure there. Chris Kiefer on the ground. We're going to have a foul.
Wow.
8 seconds off the clock, jumping around for the ball, and we already have our first foul on Jake Bolin.
But that's a good way to start for the Bears. They need energy after that last game, and what a better way to start than Christian Renninger getting on the floor and getting that ball. Good start for the Bears. If I'm coach, I'm running a set play right now. They run their sets well. Let's go set a good screen for somebody and get a shot.
I have a gut feeling Skinny Motes is holding the referee at the table trying to determine who they are giving that tap to so that we have a correct possession arrow. Referee's still discussing it. That's official stat. That's official stat keeper 101 there from Skinny Motes to be able to identify that situation, John.
And we have no arrow down there, so I'm wondering who they're giving it to.
John, see that big board on the wall that's all lit up? It's called a scoreboard. See the word possession?
Jeez.
Yeah, it's right there, John. They gave the jump ball to Owen J. Roberts. Boyertown will have next possession, which also explains why the Owen J. Roberts coach did not seem too happy by the decision either. Aggressive Boyertown. David Lay is going to go to the line as Owen Jay picks up their second team foul.
David Lay was somebody who stood out last game against Methacton, did a lot of nice stuff defensively, had a couple steals, a couple layups, and some good shot opportunities. He doesn't force anything on the offensive end. He's one of the guys in the team that kind of lets the game come to him. He's been a consistent player for the Bears so far.
He misses the first, 7:38 left in the first quarter. I really probably should say 22 seconds gone in the first quarter. As David Lay makes a second, gives Boyertown a 1-0 lead. Looks like Boyertown setting up in some full court man pressure. Little bit of miscommunication on who had whom. And that looks like Jake Boland's going to try to take it inside himself. Throws it away out of bounds. Boyertown will get possession back. And it looks like Eric Salata with a play call, John, with that. Talked about a couple weeks ago, the famous wipe. Owen Jay in their man-to-man defense. Reniger out to Salata. Going to go inside early to Chris Kiefer. He's going to put it up with a left hand. Great move from Kiefer. 3-0 Boyertown.
I don't think he's seen the ball too much down there. So, again, maybe yesterday in practice it was a point of contention. Get the ball inside, which they really didn't against Methacton. So far, Boyertown's offense is rolling here.
And so far, John, we've had two offensive sets for Boyertown and not a single look from three-point land. Which, it's 3-0. We'll see if that's something that'll be a continual trend here to rely on some of that size they have underneath. Good move there, baseline by Brody Boland. Going right around Kiefer. That makes it 3-2 Boyertown. Reniger's turn to go baseline. Kicks it out to DeGuglielmo. He'll take that wide open three. That's no good, but a great sign again. Offensive rebound, Kiefer.
Now, that was a good look there by Trey. That was a good little inside out there. I would take that three-pointer. And look at this. Working the ball, not settling for a three. Once again, inside. I think that's 5 points on the inside there, Jim. Looking good so far.
5-2 Boyertown lead. 5:56 left in the first. Boyertown still in their man-to-man defense. Owen Jay's trying to set some screens out by the three-point land. Chase Johnson puts up a shot. That's no good. DeGuglielmo with the rebound. Boyertown's going to run. Here comes Reniger. Gets stopped up on the low block. DeGuglielmo with another uncontested three-pointer, and that one falls for Trey DeGuglielmo. He has 5. Boyertown has 8. They're up 6.
No forced three-pointers yet. They're getting their threes within the offense or within the transition set. Boyertown must have done a lot of work yesterday, certainly.
John, that might have been the most excited my voice has gotten all year. I apologize to everyone if that was a little bit too loud. And that looks like Chase Johnson stepped out of bounds. Based on the last game from the Bears here, John, I don't think they could have scripted a better start to this ballgame.
And speaking of loud, you're looking at the Boyertown bench. Even the JV players are getting up and excited. The staff yesterday had a tough job to get these guys back into the winning mindset, but it looks like right now they've done that so far.
Owen Jay still in the man-to-man to Guglielmo inside the three-point line. That's still a great shot. That goes down. He was scoreless in the first half last game, ended up as the leading scorer for the game. He's not scoreless this time. 10-2 Boyertown, 4:38 left in the first. Help defense there, but David Lay stays with Johnson. That shot's no good. Eric Salata's going to take his time. He's going to drive in, tries to get it to Kiefer. And that's no good.
I don't know if I saw a walk there on that spin. It was a tough, tight pass there by Salata. Maybe should have looked to kick it out a different direction. But Bears are doing a nice job playing their man-to-man defense here the past couple of games. They were a zone team primarily in the last two games. They've seen something in their man-to-man sets that says, you know, we can go play teams, and we're seeing a different team right here energy-wise.
Preston Brindle's three-point attempt is no good, and Boyertown's going to come back with 4 minutes left in that quarter. David Lay puts that one off the glass, and that's going to cause a timeout from Owen J. Roberts.
You know, that was one of those three-pointers that they took last, you know, Wednesday night against Methacton, one of those quick ones. And you even saw it come off of Lay's hands a little, you know, hot there. You know, probably it, you know, should have reversed the ball there. But when it goes in like that, you count it, right? You count that. And you can't overstate the fact that momentum is playing a big part here. Good stuff like that happens when you're aggressive, when you have some momentum in your favor. And Boyertown has it all right now. And when have they had all the momentum this year? Just one game, it seems like. Great to see for the Bears here. Great start for them.
13-2, Boyertown lead, 3:57 left in the first quarter. Two team fouls for Owen J. Roberts, still none for Boyertown. And I made a decision to keep some stats this game. And, John, we are early on, shooting 67% from three-point land.
That's good. That's good mental math there, Jim.
Well, it's easy. Two-thirds is one of the easy fractions. But you English majors probably have a hard time with that.
True.
Running jump shot from Schermel is no good. Salada's going to take it himself. That's going to be blocked by Johnson. But Boyertown will keep possession. A lot of hollering from the Wildcat bench after that one. But that is not going to stop Salada from doing that multiple times in a game.
And that's not a bad take from Eric. I think he's kind of looking for a foul there. Didn't get it, but that doesn't mean he's not going to get it next time.
Here's a deep one from DeGuglielmo, and that one drops. Well, John, we said earlier, are they going to make their threes or are they going to miss their threes? And so far early on, they're making them.
These threes aren't contested, though. They're not forced. That was a full ball reversal to get that three. And sometimes basketball is a simple game. You reverse the ball, you know, you don't settle for your first shot down the floor. You get those easy looks sometimes, and the Bears are knocking them down.
Griffin Hummels checked into the game for Boyertown during that timeout. Owen J. Roberts still trying to find some type of momentum here on offense. They'll see if they can do that at the line as Boyertown commits their first foul. I think that's David Lay, and it is. That'll send Jace Johnson to the line, shooting two, down 16-2.
It seems like if Owen J is going to get back in this game, it's going to be a lot of Chase Johnson. He so far is their leading scorer, and seems like he has a real knack for finding the ball. It was a good take right there. So, you know, in the man-to-man defense, it's a lot easier to locate scorers. I'm kind of interested to see who they have on Johnson, who Coach Ludwig feels like is his defensive stopper. Because, once again, man-to-man hasn't been their priority yet this year, but they're making it one tonight.
Ryan Schaefer into the game for the first time, giving Chris Kiefer a rest. And there's David Lay right inside to Schaefer. And that's the type of offense I personally like to see, John. Pass to the high post, turn around, and the size that Boyertown has, that's going to be there for them all day.
Coach Detweiler trying to give Boyertown a different look right there. They went to a zone look, and Boyertown did something that they did not do early against Methacton zone on Wednesday. They got it to that high post. They looked, like you said, high-low. And if you're in the right position and you're sealing early and anticipating that pass to the high post, you should be open quite a bit down there, and Schaefer was.
Schaefer drops both from the line, just under 2:30 left in the first quarter. Boyertown with a commanding 18-3 lead on the Wildcats. Like we saw, John, we said it earlier in the game, this is a four-point victory for Owen J. Roberts on their court a few weeks ago, so there's certainly that possibility that they can still come back from this. It is early. And Boyertown's defense is doing very well right now. Johnson on the drive. Looked like he tried to pass it. Hummel over to DeGuglielmo, and that is going to drop. Trey DeGuglielmo is on fire.
And Hummel had, I'm a broken record. Hummel had an open shot on Wednesday night. He takes that. That was a great look from Griffin. That great extra pass. Get it to your guy, your scorer, the guy who's hot right now. Great decision by Griffin Hummel. He'll get his later in the game. Great decision right there by Griffin Hummel.
Renninger back in the game for Boyertown. 21-3 Boyertown lead now. Trey DiGuglielmo has 13. And we still have a minute 45 left in the first quarter. Inside to Bolin on the low block. Help from Reniger. Excuse me, down on Schaefer. Owen Jay with a quick three in front of the bench. And we're going to get a wraparound foul, I believe, on David Lay.
Go ahead. Don't be upset about that, Coach. We were always taught, take a foul rebounding the ball. Take a defensive foul rebound the ball early in the game. Set the tone, set the precedent that you were going to be physical underneath. I'm okay with that foul if it's on Lay and it's the second. Maybe not so much. But fouls like that are not bad early like this. Set the tone.
And they've certainly done that offensively and defensively. Not sure what we got going on here. Is there a technical? We'll have to get some information. Shamel's at the line. He makes one.
Well, I suppose if we see Coach Ludwig sit, then it'll have been on him. If not, it must have been on a player.
Shamel makes both of those, and I would imagine that makes it 21-5. Boyertown lead. And Skinny Motes is going to call the referees back again. Yeah, it should be Owen Jay's possession underneath the basket.
Should be Owen Jay ball foul. On the sideline, actually. There we go.
And
the refs get together and make the right call. Look at that. That's teamwork right there, Jim.
I just wish we knew what happened with 1:25 left in the first quarter. We will definitely get that information. I know we were unable to get those stats for you last game, but we will find out what happened with that one. And it does not look like it was on Coach Ludwig because he is still standing. So actually looking at the board, John, four team fouls for Boyertown. If I'm not mistaken, there were two before that. So that could be a technical on a player, potentially. As Owen Jay misses their drive, 21-5 under a minute left. There's Jake Kapp fresh into the game with a beautiful up and under for Kapp. 23-5, Boyertown lead.
Great shot by Jake Kapp there. Underneath, bad angle, putting that spin on the ball. Nice shot.
Just about 30 seconds left in the quarter. Owen Jay still trying to find some movement, some motion.
Boyertown's playing very aggressive on defense right here, so I'm not surprised that the fouls are starting to pile up for him. When your man drives baseline, you got to give them that angle. You got to make sure that you don't bump them. You have to, be moving your feet towards the bucket and almost receive that contact. And Schaefer there didn't receive the contact. He kind of initiated it and knocked the shooter off balance. So good call there on Schaefer, but the Bears have been doing a better job with their on-the-ball defense, but still can always look on things to improve. They can take better angles, cut Owen Jay off before they get all that way on the baseline, and then they might have zero opportunities to score because that's really the only way they've scored so far.
Aiden Fascioli makes one of two for Owen Jay Roberts as Salata and Kiefer check back into the game. High screen from Kiefer, easily gotten around by Shamel. Under 10 seconds left. Another high screen from Kiefer. Nice kick out to DiGuglielmo. Not surprised one bit, John. Trey DiGuglielmo drains his fourth three-pointer of the quarter. And we said last game it's either feast or famine. It has been feast so far as Boyertown ends the first quarter with a 26-6 lead over the Wildcats.
That's a smart call there by Coach Ludwig. You're putting your best shooter, your best scorer on the wing there with your best ball handler, and you're forcing Owen Jay to make a decision there. And I'm not sure why Johnson for O&J decided to leave to Guglielmo. If I'm Coach Detweiler, I might be saying, like, hey, listen, we know who their scorer is, correct? Don't leave him. Don't help. Try to face guard him. Maybe they're going to have to do something different on Trey here. But that was a great call there to put his two best players offensively in a position to take that last shot for the Bears. Speaking of just the Bears as a team, the first five games, Jim, they've been struggling to find their identity. I think they thought they were that big, long, 2-3 methodical team. And you know what? It hasn't been working the first couple of weeks, but I think I like this version of the Bears quite a bit, huh? That up-in-your-face, aggressive, man-to-man defense and transition offense. We can get used to watching games like this, Jim.
I agree, John, and I'm old school. I still like low-block basketball. And I think what we've seen here is they've gone low block a few times, and it's really, like you said, they're getting more open three-point shots. And I think a lot of that inside out is making a difference in that. As Kiefer on the sideline, that's going to be a foul. I believe that's on Fascioli. That'll be his first. John, first quarter stats for Boyertown from three-point land, 83%. Kick out to Hummel from the corner. Increasing that percentage for Boyertown. .729 left in the half. Boyertown with a 29-6 lead. It really is the tale of two teams here for the Boyertown boys basketball team.
Try not to watch on the ball here. Look at off the ball. Look at the Bears move off the ball here. Look at Kiefer help there. I know he made the shot, but you had Salada guarding somebody in the lane who was cutting through before he went back to his guy there. These Bears are moving tonight. They're moving. They're talking. They are communicating. This is basketball here.
That was a great little shot by Fascioli. John, he's a sophomore. Probably going to be mentioning his name a lot in the coming years. As Reniger takes his try from three-point land, that is no good. Owen J. Roberts with the rebound. Down by 21. And that's going to be up by Johnson. He's going to get blocked, but he will go to the line to shoot two.
Looking at Owen J's roster, I see that a freshman is among the league leaders in scoring at 12 points a game, Luke Fryer. Haven't seen him yet, so it might be an illness or, you know, an injury that's keeping him out of the game. But if that's the case, you certainly hope he's okay. But just one less thing for the Bears to worry about as they're game planning for a team that beat them last time, and it looks like they have, you know, done what they've needed to do to switch up their game plan from game one to give themselves a better chance tonight.
And Johnson able to make, guess we had a violation on that first shot.
We need like a sideline reporter, honestly.
Yeah, we do, because I'm fairly certain he did not take a three. Boyertown now with some of that inside out, high post to Kiefer, out to Salada. Owen J. Roberts and there's a long one from Salada. That's no good. Rebound from Bolin. Pretty cocky there from the O&J bench calling air ball with a 20-point deficit. But they have to do something to get themselves back in the game, that's for sure. Here's a three-pointer from Johnson. That's off the front of the rim. Salada will run it back the other end. Underneath to Guglielmo. He's going to put that up with a left hand. I don't think Trey Guglielmo is going to miss tonight.
Jim, the Jim Jinx is real. Can you...
Yeah, you know what?
Can you cool it?
I should watch that. You're right. Trey, I apologize if at the 5:38 mark in the second quarter, I will take full responsibility for that if it happens. But maybe my powers only apply to the opposing team as Fascioli drains a three. The sophomore for Owen J. Roberts leads all Wildcat scorers now with 9. There's a turnover. 31-12 Boyertown lead. There's a stop and pop, and that's well long. Rebound Salada.
I don't mind that shot from Shermel. You had a one-on-one situation. If you go in there, the layup would be it'd be tough if you don't get fouled. So not a bad shot selection there, but nice job by the Bears to corral that rebound and get down the other way.
John, you don't see the stop and pop very often anymore, do you?
Not anymore, no.
Fascioli around to the foul line. That's going to be long. Reniger with the rebound. Looks like they're going to call a foul on Hummel. They're pointing under the basket. I take that back. That foul's on.
It's getting a little chippy down there. And you know
Johnson,
what?
Johnson, maybe? Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a bad thing for Bordertown to get a little chippy thing here, because the lack of emotion showed in these previous couple of games was certainly not what you need to win a basketball game. So you don't want to see anybody get hurt. You don't want to do anything that is derogatory to the other team. But if things get a little chippy, yeah, that's going to happen. That's part of the game, and that's not a bad thing for this Bordertown team right now. They need that.
All right, so just to reset here, Bordertown's got a 33-12 lead, 4:35 left in the half. Some conversations from the referees here. We're going to have Chase Johnson at the line. No, I take that back. That's Preston Brindle at the line shooting one-on-one, and he misses the first.
Nice box out by Jordan Butler there. Sometimes you forget about that shooter, and you just go and just kind of suck down into that rim. Good job by Butler taking his responsibility and getting that rebound.
Butler into the game for the first time, and there's David Lay getting it from the top of the key. John, that's what I was saying before. There's the basketball I like. Pass to the top of the key. Use your big guys at the bottom. Put your hands up. Hit the hands that are up. Don't put the ball down. He gets fouled. He's going to the line shooting one more.
Something that Chris Kiefer and trade to Guglielmo and David Lay the other night against Methacton did when they caught the ball in that high post. They didn't turn opposite. They didn't look for that low. They just looked for those shooters on the outside at the arc. And then and Methacton knew that, and they weren't worried about the block. They were only worried about those shooters. But the last two times Kiefer's caught the ball in that foul line, he's turned opposite. He found his guy down low. And I think it resulted in two layups for the Bears.
36-12 is the Bordertown lead. 4:15 left in the half. Owen J. Roberts trying to find some motion, some understanding of their offense here. They're going to get an offensive foul call against Sam Schrammell that's going to delete the little jump shot from Fascioli from the baseline.
Referees are not immune to the energy in the gym. You know, Bordertown's bringing the energy. They're being physical on defense. And the more physical you are, referees call, sometimes they call less because they don't want to bring the game down to a halt. They can sense the momentum shift in the gym. Sometimes they give you that when the momentum's going your way.
And there is some ball movement that finds Jake Kapp open for a three-pointer. And he's able to drain that one.
And that's good for Jake. He's been struggling with his shot the last couple games. Good to see him make one. Hopefully he can make a couple more tonight.
Got another foul on the floor. It's going to send Sam Schrammell to the line, shoot one and one. Schrammell makes the first one. He's perfect from the line so far tonight for Owen J. Roberts. And the Jim Towers jinx does not work tonight. He's 4-for-4 from the line. 39-14 is the Bordertown lead. 3 minutes and 20 seconds left in the half. DeGuglielmo at the scores table to come back in. Looks like Owen J. Roberts back into a man-to-man. Fascioli with a steal. They're going to find Bolin inside. He's going to be fouled, and he'll go to the line to shoot two.
Nice job by Schrammell, kind of regathering himself there, not trying to do too much with that awkward layup he would have had there. Good look for him as he found Bolin streaking down as a trailer there on that play.
Preston Brindle looking for his first points of the game. Unable to do it on that first one. My jinx is back, John.
Well, I think you said the wrong name, so you're jinxing the wrong person, but it worked, I guess. So,
why? Who's at the line?
Bolin, I think.
Oh, that's not 32? I'm at a bad angle from where I'm sitting. You're right. It's Bolin.
Okay.
It's Bolin. He made the second one. And he comes down the other end and puts up a great block. 2:58 left. 39-15, Boyertown lead.
So if you're O&J, you're thinking that the Guglielmo is probably going to try and get this ball.
And that's exactly what they tried to do, but it's chipped out away by Johnson. He finds Fascioli on the near side. O&J Roberts going to try to get an offensive set here against the man-to-man. Great hustle from Jordan Butler. That's what you like to see. Ends up in the stands. And Renninger comes in to relieve Jordan Butler. Good hustle there by Butler for Boyertown.
It was a nice run for Jordan. He doesn't really need to do much offensively with his role on this team, but he is somebody who's athletic enough to make a defensive, to have a defensive presence for the Bears. I know he had that one turnover there, but he's the kind of player who might happen to him, but he's going to get it back on the defensive end eventually. So good to see him get on the floor for some good minutes.
Here's Johnson with a three-pointer. That falls. Owen J. Roberts definitely needed that. See what Boyertown can answer with. Jay Capp finds the Guglielmo underneath. He must have been a little bit too close to the basket on that one because he needed a second opportunity, but it falls.
It's a nice entry pass there by Capp. Almost got intercepted by O&J, but good job by Trey holding that seal there and getting that shot for a layup.
23-point lead for Boyertown, under 2 minutes left. Salada tries to knock that away. He's successful. May have gotten away with a foul there.
That's what I mean, Jim. I think that was definitely a foul, but the Bears have been so aggressive. The referees are used to it. They're not going to call that. The more aggressive you are sometimes, the more stuff you can get away with.
Owen J. Roberts trying to find some holes and get some motion amongst his man-to-man defense. They're not able to find it. They find Fascioli, who's been the only bright spot, really, this half offensively for O&J. He's long on that three-pointer. Renninger's going to drive. He's going to find Schaefer. Salada's three-pointer is no good. Long rebound to Schaefer inside to Renninger. Salada all by himself will put up another three, and that one will fall for Eric Salada.
Again, unselfish basketball there. Unselfish, and the Bears are once again rolling here. It's a good quarter for them.
44-18 is their lead now. 44 seconds left. They find Fascioli. He's unable to convert on that layup. 28 seconds. Did I hear Coach Ludwig yell one shot, John?
And he should have. In rewatching their game last time, the Bears took a three-pointer with about 15 seconds left, did not make it, and O&J came down and scored much similar to this right here, and it kind of changed the momentum. Obviously, it was a much closer game last time, but let's see if the Bears can get something here.
Fascioli makes the layup. Renninger's three-pointer is no good. And they do not call a foul on that last-second three-point heave by Sam Schrammell. But we were talking about feast or famine, John. We certainly got feast on the Boyertown end. They lead 44-20 going into halftime.
Again, maybe the Bears are finding their identity. And I said it last game, this is a team that seems like they would have benefited from a couple of non-leaguers to start their year out, to kind of figure out who they were as a team. But they're being aggressive. That aggressiveness on defense is spilling over into offense, where they're attacking the glass. They're looking for each other. They're communicating. They're not settling for those three-pointers that they did on Wednesday. They're probably going to look. Now, let's just say things keep going this way. There's still a half to play, and O&J came back from a 12-point deficit in the last 8.5 minutes of that game. a few weeks ago. So O&J could do it again here, but if the game stays this way, this is one of those games where you look back and say, man, why did we play so much zone that first game? Why did we slow the pace down so much? But moving forward, if the Bears can keep playing like this and keep this intensity, then maybe this is who they are the rest of the season. And if it is, good for them.
I unofficially have Boyertown at 73% from three-point land in the first half, which is remarkable. Leading scorer for Boyertown is not going to shock anybody. Trey DiGuglielmo, almost half of the points for Boyertown. He has 20. And Aiden Fasolioli, almost half of the points for O&J Roberts. He has 9. Two very different players. Trey, a senior, tall and long, able to do a lot on the court. Fasioli, first time seeing him play, younger, sophomore, a little more versatile, a little bit of Eric Salata to him, creates. So we're seeing two different things tonight here, but similar results from both players.
Yeah, and when it comes to Trey and what he did in the first half, had a great first half, but remember that upper perk game. I know that the final score was, 30-40 points for the Bears, but in that second half, did they make a three-pointer in that second half, Jim? I think they made maybe all of them in the first half. Maybe they made one in the second, but they went cold in the second half. That's going to happen sometimes. You hope it doesn't happen here for the Bears, but if I'm Coach Ludwig right now at halftime, I'm saying, guys, obviously great half. Do not settle for those three-pointers here in the third quarter. Do not take a few three-pointers, miss two or three in a row, and then give O&J a chance to get back in this game. Let's do the same thing we did in the first half. Be looking for that high post, that high-low. Try to get that ball inside. And then when it does get inside, then flood that corner if you can get there for a kick out for a three. Move to that open area. Call for the ball. You'll get an open three if you can get it inside and then move a bit on the arc. But don't be running down in transition, jacking the three-pointers that we did earlier in the week. And if they can focus on not putting up those wild three-pointers that they did and focus on keeping the ball inside, getting those points in the lane, getting to the foul line, then that's the formula, I think, for them to keep this game at, double-digit lead.
Well, we have just under 7 minutes left in the halftime. Once again, it's a 44-20 lead for Boyertown. If the scoreboard is correct, O&J Roberts will have possession to start the second half, which is certainly something that I'm sure they are very happy about. And, John, it's certainly that time of the night where we got to start thinking dinner, man. You know, like I said last week, it's a 15-minute conversation with my wife about what we're going to get. So if she's listening, Danielle, if you're listening, let's start that now. Start thinking about what you want.
You know, Jim, I honestly don't know what's going to happen tonight. I feel like I have to save some money, and here's why. Valentine's Day on Sunday, right? So I got my wife a pair of slippers.
So clearly she's not listening, or you don't care.
I don't know. I don't know if she's listening.
Sorry, Abby. That wasn't my fault. That's all your fantastic husband.
I got her a pair of slippers, which, to our audience here, she wanted the slippers. I'm not just, some cheapskate buying, a pair of slippers from her. She said she wanted them. I listen. I'm a good listening husband. I listened to her. I got her the slippers. Now, she kind of surprised me today. She's not happy with my sweatpants collection. She says they're old, they're ratty, they're too baggy. She wants me, as she says, to come into the 21st century and get a pair of joggers. You know what those are, Jim?
I do. I'm aware.
The tight bottoms there.
Yes.
I really wasn't a fan, but she said, I want you to try this out. And I said, okay. So she stopped at Old Navy and got me a pair of joggers. And I said, okay, these are nice. They're nice. And she said, oh, thank God you like them. I said, why? What did you spend on these? Jim, I am right now wearing a $50 pair of sweatpants. Are you kidding me?
Wow. Looks like you're having peanut butter and jelly Uncrustable sandwiches for dinner tonight, John. John, you mentioned earlier about how your wife wanted slippers. You know, I said a couple weeks ago, I'm on the other end of the 40 decade, inching closer to 50. You know what I asked my wife for my birthday, and she listened and came through and got it for me?
A gift for a 40, 50-year-old. I don't know what.
nose hair trimmer, John.
Hey,
that is a true story.
With mask wearing, you don't need to trim your nose hair. What do you got to trim your nose hair for?
Well, John, I don't wear the mask at home. And you know, it's I've used it a few times, and I have to say it's very air tastes better through your nose. It really, really does. And there's a lot of things that stink about getting old. And that's one of them. We got about 4 minutes left until the start of the second half. We will be back with you momentarily on the NFHS Network. We are back. We have 1 minute and 55 seconds left in halftime as the teams finish their warm-ups. We were able to get some information from our sideline information people. I guess we really don't have any other formal name for them. But earlier in the game, David Lay was called for a personal foul, and we were thinking that a technical had been called, and we weren't sure what was going on with that. Turns out, this day and age, John, one thing assistant coaches are not permitted to do is say anything to the referees, correct?
True.
And apparently, Coach Travis Miller said something to a referee. And Travis Miller, assistant coach for Boyertown Area Senior High School, was awarded a technical for that. John, you do have some experience with that.
Do you have to bring it up, Jim?
Yes, I do, John, because what is your middle name?
Paul.
And I introduce you as John T. Coleta every night. There's a reason for that. We won't go into that story, but some halftime when we have a little extra time, because, John, you're technical when you were coaching. Was it JV you were coaching?
Yeah, it was JV.
That's one of my favorite stories. So we'll keep the fans waiting. That's called a tease, John. Some other game in the future, we'll tell that story.
Now we're throwing out real TV terms here. This is really turning into an operation here.
That it is. The clock is set at 8 minutes. We're about to start the third quarter. Owen Jay absolutely was correct with the scoreboard. They will have possession. And they're going to need to do something quickly here, John.
They do. They need to shave off a few points here in the first 2 or 3 minutes of this quarter. While the Bears, if they want to keep this momentum, it'd be good for them to extend this lead a little bit if they can the first couple minutes.
And that is exactly what Owen Jay Roberts needed. A three-pointer from Jake Boleyn. But here comes DeGuglielmo to answer. And that's going to be long. Rebound, Owen J. Roberts. This is what you were talking about at halftime, John. But Salada with the steal. And he's going to run it out to Reniger. Goes up and under, and somehow that ball goes in for Christian Reniger. And he'll go to the line to shoot one more.
Christian Renninger hanging in the air under the rim for, you know, for somebody like me who is not too tall, trying to, you know, shoot layups during my high school career. We were always taught you want to use that rim to protect your shot there. And man, did he just do that there. Could have gone up on that left side. Use the rim to protect his shot. Great reverse layup there. Big play for the Bears here early.
That foul shot's off the front of the rim. Owen J. Roberts with the rebound. See what they can do. 45-23 is the score. Renninger's, looks like Renninger's going to get called for a push down on the low block.
Things change sometimes after halftime with shooting. We've talked about that, but sometimes with refereeing as well. I don't think that Christian Renninger foul gets called in the first half, but here it might. They might start calling a tighter game here. Watch for those Bordertown fouls. See if they start to get up there.
Sam Schermel misses from 3-point. Good to see DeGuglielmo give that one up as David Lay, tough underneath, but that Bordertown size, Lay and Kiefer able to handle that. And DeGuglielmo gives up one where he was covered for one where he's not, and that pays off. That three goes in. .633 left, 48-23 is the Bordertown lead. Bordertown back into man-to-man defense. Surprised to not see Fascioli out on the court for Owen J. Roberts as the Wildcats reverting back to their starting five. That drive by Bolin is not good. Great little seam pass from Salada, unfortunately. Stays a little low. DeGuglielmo not able to pick that one up.
You kind of saw that play develop. You kind of knew what Eric was going to do there. It did close quickly there, but again, a playmaker like Eric Salada, you're gonna take a couple of them in the game because you know he's going to make more plays for you than he is gonna miss.
And Eric Salada not happy with that foul call, and I'm going to have to agree with him, John. I'm sitting here as you're talking about it, I'm thinking my comment was going to be he comes down on that turnover and does a great job defensively. And he gets called for a foul. I really thought he moved his feet nicely on that play, but referees disagree. And Schermel misses the first foul shot. Bordertown already with two team fouls, 5:54 left in the third quarter. Schermel makes the second. 49-24. Is the score of Bordertown over Owen Jay. Owen Jay with a little bit of full court pressure here. Dropping back, and there's DeGuglielmo with it. He finds Lay, who's all alone. Owen Jay Roberts' coach is going to have to do something about this, John. They're just getting way too many open three-pointers.
Now, that there, though, I don't know if I take that shot. You saw Coach Lubbock there on the sideline. If you rewind that tape, he kind of put his head down and said, okay, good, we made that good, but if Owen Jay, that's what Owen Jay wants right there. They're trying to speed this tempo up. They want quick shots by Bordertown, and they're going to probably allow you to take shots like this, because if they miss it, Owen Jay is going the other way. So that was two big makes there for the Bears. But if I'm Coach Ludwig, I might say, hey, listen, look at the time, look at the situation. If we break that press, if you got an open layup, take it. If not, let's get a few ball reversals. Let's make the game shorter here. Let's not give Owen Jay any sort of quick runouts off a long rebound off a missed three.
John, that three-pointer from Renninger does shorten the game because we are at the 31-point mark, John.
Wow, good call. I thought you were going to say that three was brought to you by...
I don't know who it would have been brought to you by, John.
Gillette nose hair trimmers.
It's got three. It doesn't have three speeds, John, but it does have three purposes.
Jim, if you need three speeds for your nose hair, you got problems.
No, it's the directions say that it is intended use is for nose hair, ear hair, and there is an attachment to trim up the sideburns. So it does have three uses. So that three-pointer brought to you by the three uses of my new nose hair trimmer. I was going to say brought to you by the number three at McDonald's, but I never get the number three. Chris Kiefer with the rebound over to Salada. He's going to run. He's going to find DeGuglielmo in the corner. He's all alone, and he drains it. 58-24 is the score now. Boyertown ahead.
You know, it's funny to see different people's reactions to things. You know, Jim, the phones here are very active during the game. We're getting text messages from our super fans out there, from people like Coach Rico Houck and Coach TJ Miller, some of our super fans out there. And the text I'm seeing right now on the wire here are try to put them away. Don't be passing the ball around. Put them away. So, you know, difference of opinion there, but I can't argue with it. They've still shot the ball well here in the third quarter, and they are in the process of putting the other team away right now. So I guess why take your foot off the gas?
Schrammel converts on a three-point play there for Owen J. Roberts. Underneath to Kiefer. Hummel into the game for Boyertown. Gets it out to Lay. There's a drive by Salata. And he's going to get called for a walk.
Was that a pass from Eric?
I think it was a shot that ended up in Kiefer's hands.
Oof.
Because if it was a pass, it was the best pass I've ever seen.
Correct.
And I'm impressed that your text line there, John, is so into the game details. I thought they were really going to be discussing your shopping skills of slippers and $55 sweatpants.
Yes, Mike.
Whereas those are your fans, and you know, my fans are here texting my daughter, Kate, out at the University of Pittsburgh.
Hey.
She just texted that we're cracking her up.
Once again, the college has changed. But again, what is it? What time is it? They don't go out for another 2.5 hours, right? So
that is correct, John. It's not even 8 o'clock. And it's COVID. You know, it's one thing I've noticed, very, very different for those kids.
True.
Schaefer doing something inside. He's bodying his way, unable to be successful. But here's Roman Marinello, first time into the game. Gets the loose ball. Reniger finds Schaefer just inside the three-point line. He's going to take a very long two. That hits every part of the rim. But as the cheerleaders say, does not go in. 58-27, clock continues to run. 2:24 left in the third quarter.
The way the bench reacted there, seems like Ryan Schaefer maybe hasn't taken too many of those shots in practice or in games, so almost went down for him.
You know, that was the type of shot, John, that we talk about as a three-pointer goes in for Jake Bolin. Talk about analytics and sports. That long two-pointer from right inside the three-point line is something that nobody wants you to take anymore. Why waste your time with that if you can move back a foot and get an extra point? Boyertown's going to get called for a foul underneath the basket. 28-point lead.
Yeah, Christian Reniger, nice job there faking that little dribble handoff there and getting to the rim. Ryan Schaefer, though, probably a good call here. Ryan Schaefer was called for clearing out the way there, and Coach Ludwig's trying to ask about it. But, you know, you're not allowed to displace that defender under that basket while somebody else is going. And it looks like, do we have another technical foul here on the Bears?
We do, John. And I also don't know if the Owen J. Roberts coaches saw, but as I'm sitting here watching, the clock was running while he was at the foul line.
And I
do not believe that that's supposed to happen.
It is not supposed to, however. It's, you know,
they didn't stop it after a few seconds. I mean, it was at least 122 when it was going down. And that was Fascioli at the line back into the game as
they still could fix it right now if they wanted to. But if they don't know about it, we're probably going to just have the clock start.
I don't think anybody noticed it. Still a 28-point lead for Boyertown. Brindle trying to do something there on the baseline. He's going to get the ball underneath his basket. 1 minute left in the third quarter. Johnson back into the game for the Wildcats. Drexel is their inbound play. Three across the foul line. One at the block. Results in a long three-pointer that is short. 40 seconds left in the third. Roman Marinello handling the point guard duties against Owen J. Roberts man-to-man. Christian Reniger. Back up to Marinello. Boyertown clearly waiting for the last shot.
It was a pick and roll last time. Let's see what they do here. Same thing.
There's the pick. There's the roll. And there's the drive, but there is Kiefer. No good. Guglielmo comes from the other end for a rebound. That's no good. 1 second, last second shot up by Fascioli is no good. We head to the fourth quarter with Boyertown leading 58-30.
You're starting to see Boyertown figure things out in all facets of the game here. We talked defensively how they're kind of figuring out who they are, their identity as a defensive team. It seems like if they go back to his own defense in these next couple of games, I will run down there and shake Mike Ludwig until he plays man-to-man. They are playing aggressive man-to-man defense, and they need to stick with that. Did not think that was going to be their identity early in the season. Offensively, I did not think they'd be so transition-based here in the offensive sets, but I still do think that they run their sets well, but when they slow that pace down, we've seen them kind of lose their energy, lose that intensity. They need to keep pushing the ball in transition. And now you're seeing them kind of figure out what their go-to plays are at the end of quarters. I mean, that's a play that has honestly worked twice for them tonight. It worked with the three-pointer earlier in the game, but it worked there and got Christian Reniger and Chris Kiefer some good opportunities there. So this is a team, you could sense it. I was talking to some players and coaches yesterday. You could sense it. They think they're close. They think they're right there. And maybe it just takes a little revenge game like this to make it all work the rest of the way.
There's Hummel. Gives up a three-pointer. Drives, which is short. And he's going to fight with Chase Johnson underneath the basket to force a jump ball. And Owen J. Robbins will have possession.
Once again, set play there. Hummel had a good look. Bears run their sets well.
Still a 28-point game. Boyertown lead. Bears still in a man-to-man set. Jake Kapp up high. A lot of pressure from Boyertown. 15-foot jump shot from Chase Johnson is good.
Chase Johnson likes that little pull-up shot, and you're right. That's a lost art, that pull-up shot. Chase Johnson does a nice job with his body control there, going up quick off of that last dribble. I like him as a player and what he does offensively.
John, we haven't mentioned it yet this year. Very disappointed in Chris Kiefer. We talked about it at the practice. Watching the Sixer game a couple nights ago, he reminds me of somebody that I'm also very disappointed in, is De'Aaron Fox. Have you seen the Sacramento Kings play lately?
He didn't cut his hair, did he?
De'Aaron Fox cut his hair. The easiest way to identify him on the court, and Chris Kiefer cut his hair. I actually have to look at the number now because I get him confused with Ryan Schaefer. Never had to worry about that before. Boyertown gets called with a foul. That's their seventh. But I learned a few years ago, John, that's an offensive foul, so that is not a one-on-one.
Correct. You got it.
As we said before, right on cue, Ryan Schaefer gets up to check into the game. Next stoppage of action. Owen J. Roberts now going to be going to the well, not surprisingly, for their three-pointers. That one from Jake Bolin is no good. They did cut the lead to 26. And they'll go to the line to shoot two.
With the Bears right now, you're holding a 26-point advantage here in a game where the clock is running. You're not going to have too much more time on the court here. I think you still want to set goals for your team, and now what those goals are kind of dependent on what you want out of your team here. But can the Bears in the last 5 minutes here, can they get Can they get to 70? You know, let's make that a goal. If I'm Coach Lubbock, I'm saying, listen, we are not going to just run clock here and just run the game out. Yeah, we want to take some time off the clock and ball reversal and get good looks, but let's get six more baskets here. Let's get 70 points. And defensively, can we let up less than 40?
Here's Jordan Butler. Drives baseline. It looked like he was in slow motion there. He was able to get baseline, put that one up, cleared out by Ryan Schaefer. Good job by Butler with his first basket of the game. Sam Strmel comes back in response for Owen J. Roberts to put in two. Game still at 26 points with just over 5 minutes left. Now there's a shot Humble would have taken the last couple games, Sean.
Correct.
Inside to Schaefer, finds Cap, who's open, and that's going to be just long. Good rebound there from number 14 for Owen J. Roberts.
There's that quick look there.
Yeah, Hummel's three-pointer doesn't fall. Owen J. Roberts will come back with Johnson. He gets fouled. They'll shoot one and one. So we chase Johnson at the line. He's 2 for 4 on the night from the stripe. Make that 3 for 5.
All right. Box out by Jake Capp there.
Great box out. Thanks, able to get that box out due to my jinx. That is alive and well here in Boyertown Gym. Jordan Butler hands off to Hummel. See, there must have been some instruction from Coach Ludwig, Mike, because great move underneath there by Ryan Schaefer. That ball came around the court to Griffin Hummel there at the top of the key. He did not even look at the basket.
Which time and situation, probably the right thing to do. Get your shot after a couple of ball reversals. Take some time off the clock. Work the ball. Get a shot for your teammates. Get yours within the offense. Don't force anything right now at this point.
3 minutes and 25 seconds left in the game. Coach Ludwig going to his bench. A few of his young players at the table ready to come in. Nice three-point shot there from Chase Johnson. Able to convert. Zach Ward and Richard Black into the game for Boyertown. There's just a great move by Ryan Schaefer. A little bit too hard. I think he wasn't expecting to be so open with how big of a body he had there, but it was a very, very nice move on the low block.
You're watching Ryan a lot on the JV squad this year and then varsity squad this year. He does have a good sense of what to do down on the block, close to the rim. And that's something that I know that the staff has been working with him on, kind of, you know, developing those offensive moves. Now, on the JV floor last year, I know finishing was something that got better for him as the year went on, but it's still something that you can always get better at. And it looks like he has, you know, just a little bit to learn about body control and you know, speed of moves and where to throw that ball off the rim. But big kid, good size, and from what I hear, good learner as well. Likes to learn, likes the game. So you know, excited for him here to be here for the future of this team.
2:18 left in the game, 62-39, Boyertown lead. We have another foul call.
I think that was a quick time to get a sub in. As a coach, I was always too afraid to do that, to ask for that like quick timeout to get somebody in but then not take it. I never really knew if it counted against me or not. I don't know. I just never did it.
Well, whatever it did, it worked for them because they got their sub into the game, and they are going to be sending Tristan Dietrich to the line to shoot two. One thing we can say O.J. Roberts won in this second half is the foul game. Boyertown is well over the limit at 10. O.J. Roberts only committed one team foul as Dietrich misses the first. So, John, dinner, what are we thinking?
Well, if you're going to Argento's again, I might be seeing you there for my wife.
Yeah, I don't think I'm doing Argento's again.
Okay. She loves their Stromboli's there, and she deserves it. Worked hard this week. Works hard every day. But for me tonight, I think I might go across the street from Argento's and get me a couple of things of sushi from the Panda Garden tonight.
Panda Garden sushi does not sound bad, John. We'll see if my what my wife's thoughts about that are. As we get to the 120 mark, Owen J. Roberts able to cut this down to a 22-point lead. You know, it certainly is a difference in the pandemic with the change in the rule of only a 30-point game with a running clock. They did do a number into this lead. Not saying they would have come back, but they really didn't get much higher than a couple above 30 as Jordan Butler goes inside. They're going to wave that off. Call that offensive.
Referees do, they'll say they don't, but they do try to even things up here, and this half, you know, it didn't really matter too much as we look at the scoreboard, but you know, if some coaches just have a knack for subtly talking to the referees and kind of getting what they want foul-wise in certain situations of the game. So, you know, I'm sure Coach Detweiler was kind of on them in the first half with some calls that he didn't agree with, and got the foul win here in the second half, but luckily not the win in the grand scheme of things here. Great game today by the Bears.
Another foul against Bordertown. That's going to send Derek Perry to the line. Another sophomore varsity player for the Wildcats. He puts one in. As does the second go down for Perry. 20-point game now. Boyertown doesn't even have to bring the ball along across half court. They will. And that'll end it. Boyertown certainly does avenge that loss down in Owen J. Roberts down in Chester County a few weeks ago, John, with another very impressive shooting performance and a 20-point victory against the Wildcats, 62-42.
Once again, it's a shame that the coaching staff is probably going to look at this game and go, man, please let us replay that first game of the year knowing what we know now. But moving forward, like we said earlier, it sometimes takes a game like this. It takes games like they had earlier this week where there are some wake-up calls in there. You learn about yourself as a player and what you have as a group. And then it takes a game like this where things come together, you try out some new things, things work, things stick, and then it's games like this, Jim, that propel you to great things during your season. Like we said last game, league titles probably out of the mix right now for the Bears, but with their remaining schedule and the way they played today, a district berth and a good seed in the district tournament is still something that is on the table for them, and that's got to be the carrot that Coach Ludwig dangles in front of his team as he just kind of helps them get better at their man-to-man defense, helps them understand offense a little bit you know, more and how to work that ball and how to find open spots and when to take the shot and when not to. But all the decisions that were made on Wednesday that you looked at and went, I don't know about that. Most of them were correct tonight. Bears made some great decisions tonight on the floor. Staff did a great job preparing them for this game. Big win for the Bears tonight, avenging that early season loss.
Trey DiGuglielmo, again, not a surprise, leads all scorers with 26. He had 6 three-pointers of his own, John, and my unofficial, I have to say unofficial, because I certainly do not have the statistician acumen as others do, but I'm unofficially putting them at 75% from three-point land tonight.
That's not true. No.
Okay.
No.
Then I definitely missed some attempts.
People don't shoot 75% in NBA 2K, whatever PlayStation game there is now.
Well, I'll rewatch it, John, and I'll see.
Okay, do that.
See if I can come up with a more accurate count. A little more balanced. Boyertown also, good night from David Lay. He had 10. A little more balance from Owen J. Roberts. Lead scorer Sam Schirmel with 10. I'm sorry, Chase Johnson with 11. Sam Schirmel put in 10. Aiden Fasciola with 9. Jake Bolin with 7. And Brody Bolin with 3. So we'll see what happens with the weather. Got a little bit, a couple more systems coming next week. And I think my mind has turned to sushi, John. What kind of sushi do you get?
Well, it's all about how much you want, Jim. Do you want something that's big enough for a meal? Then you got to go with something like the teapot roll. The teapot roll, you get about, you know, I think it's like 10 to 12 pieces of sushi. They put this, like, you know, special dressing on top of it. I think lumped crab meat on top of that. Or do you want something small? You want to get the $5 or $6 rolls. There's your spicy tuna rolls, your Philadelphia rolls. It's all about size and portions here, Jim, and what you want.
John, if I'm going meal for sushi, I'm going the sushi sashimi combo.
Ooh, there you go.
Do you eat the sashimi? Do you eat the raw, like the actual, just the raw fish?
Once. I'd stick to sushi, though, usually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's got a combination of that. I'm a big fan of that. The spider roll is also very good.
Yes, it is. Correct.
Soft shell crab is very good in that. So I think this is twice now, John. You've convinced us for dinner. It was the chef salad for my wife a couple weeks ago. Now it's sushi.
I do enjoy planning our date nights, you and me, on the air so everybody can hear them. That is a high point of my day.
Well, I'm happy to hear that, John, and we're going to say goodnight, and we'll be back on the NFHS Network with some more dinner discussion peppered with some basketball action.